The risen one has come alongside us on our journey from the empty tomb.
He speaks to us with love and encouragement, the word that frees us from our sorrows.
A guest among us, he becomes the host.
He makes himself known still today in the breaking of bread.
Let us celebrate the promise of life, for Christ is risen.
Christ is risen indeed. Hallelujah.
Living God, as we continue to celebrate the resurrection of Christ, we pray that we may be bound together in Christian love, and that our faith and fellowship may be a witness through which your Spirit will bring others into your church. We humbly thank you for your many blessings you have given us. We ask that we may learn how to truly be Easter people and always remember that we are celebrating Resurrection Day every day. For we pray through Jesus the Christ, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Friends, just last week we heard these powerful words from John's first letter. This is the message we have heard from Jesus and proclaim to you, that God is light, and in God there is no darkness at all. If we say that we have fellowship with God while we are walking in darkness, we lie and do not do what is true. But if we walk in the light, as Jesus himself is in the light, we have fellowship with one another, and the blood of Jesus, his Son, cleanses us from all sin. With the peace that comes from knowing Jesus and the power of the resurrection, let us confess our sins. Wondrous God, we confess that at times our doubts and fears override our hope and faith. Forgive us when we lose sight of the joy of your love and instead fall into despair and gloom. Lift up our spirits, Lord, and help us to remember the promise of new life here and now, not just the hope of the resurrection for the future. We give thanks for your Son, Jesus the Christ, who continues to offer us new life, who continues to turn us around and upside down, who continues to break down the walls of death in our own life. Forgive us, restore us, and renew us. In the name of our risen Savior, Jesus the Christ, we pray. Amen. The tomb is empty. The stone is rolled away. There is no darkness now, only light. God continues to renew us and restore us. We are forgiven, loved, and restored, receiving the gift and promise of new life and resurrection now. Friends, we have experienced the wondrous news of God's love in Jesus the Christ. Friends, believe the good news of the gospel. In Jesus Christ, we are forgiven. Time and time again in the resurrection narratives, we find the disciples withdrawn, hiding, huddled in fear. And Jesus keeps saying to them, "Why are you afraid? My peace I give to you." It is still true today for you and for me. Why are we so afraid? Receive God's peace. The peace of the Lord be with you all.
And also with you.
Take a moment now and find ways to share Christ's peace to those present with you and virtually to those you worship with today. Good morning and welcome to worship at Frederick Presbyterian Church on this third Sunday of Easter. Please know we are delighted by your presence with us today. For those who are familiar, obviously Pastor Eric and I have swapped roles for this Sunday, hopefully giving him a bit of a break from what has been a busy Lent and Easter season. And if you're new to our church and congregation, just stay tuned. Eric will be back in leading worship next Sunday. Now, for those of you new to us, we invite you to send us a message via Facebook or email just to help us to get to know you. You'll also find on our website our worship guide along with pertinent information about our church, our weekly update, and other essential information about FPC ministries and ways that you might be a part of us and connect to our community and to our world. You'll find us several things that are relevant. Youth are meeting at their normal time now again at 5:30. We want to thank the youth as well as all of you who made our hygiene drive so successful. You'll see words about VBS and holding dates for June, July, and August, all kinds of things that are important. So find your way to our website and let's be aware. I want to also invite our children and younger church to just gather for just a moment. A quick word for you today. Have you ever been to a surprise party? You know, have you ever been a part of surprising someone else, or perhaps you have been surprised by your mom or dad or your siblings? Surprises can be both good and bad, but I like to think most surprises are a very good thing. I mean, at parties, we get to blow those things that make noise and the streamers come out, and we wear hats and sing and all kinds of good things, and it's the surprise that makes this moment kind of memorable, special. Well, the Easter story tells us that following Jesus' death, he came back to life. And Jesus' followers, his disciples, they didn't know what to do. They didn't know what this meant for them. And so they were often hiding away and talking among themselves or trying to walk away from Jerusalem. And surprise, surprise, Jesus shows up. Jesus comes to them to help them be aware that he is alive. He talks with them. He has a meal with them. He invites them to see the wounds in his feet and his hands. Jesus wanted his followers to know he lives. And there was no need for us to worry or be afraid. Jesus doesn't want us to worry either. And his promise is to be with us and guide us and help us. And that is really good news. Let's pray. Lord, help us to journey in a way that makes us aware of all the ways you reveal yourself to us. Through Christ, we pray. Amen.
Let us pray. O God of resurrection, O God of new life, by the power of your Holy Spirit, restore our sight, that as the word is read and proclaimed, as the word is heard, that we may see the risen Lord, in whose name we pray. Amen. Our first reading is from the Acts of the Apostles. When Peter saw it, he addressed the people, "You Israelites, why do you wonder at this, or why do you stare at us as though by our own power or piety we had made him walk? The God of Abraham, the God of Isaac, and the God of Jacob, the God of our ancestors, has glorified his servant Jesus, whom you handed over and rejected in the presence of Pilate, though he had decided to release him. But you rejected the holy and righteous one and asked to have a murderer given to you. And you killed the author of life, whom God raised from the dead. To this we are witnesses. And by faith in his name itself has made this man strong, whom you see and know. And the faith that is through Jesus has given him this perfect health in the presence of all of you. And now, friends, I know that you acted in ignorance, as did also your rulers. In this way, God fulfilled what he had foretold through all the prophets, that his Messiah would suffer. Repent, therefore, and turn to God, so that your sins may be wiped out." The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The psalm appointed for this morning is Psalm 4. We read together. "Answer me when I call, O God, defender of my cause. You set me free when I was in distress. Have mercy on me and hear my prayer. You mortals, how long will you dishonor my glory? How long will you love illusions and seek after lies? Know that the Lord does wonders for the faithful. The Lord will hear me when I call. Tremble then and do not sin. Speak to your heart in silence upon your bed. Offer the appointed sacrifices and put your trust in the Lord. Many are saying, who will show us any good? Let the light of your face shine upon us, O Lord. You have put gladness in my heart, more than when grain and wine abound. In peace I will lie down and sleep. For you alone, O Lord, make me rest secure." Our second reading is from the Epistle of 1 John. "See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God, and that is what we are. The reason the world does not know us is that it did not know him. Beloved, we are God's children now. What we will be has not yet been revealed. What we do know is this: when he is revealed, we will be like him, for we will see him as he is. And all who have this hope in him purify themselves just as he is pure. Everyone who commits sin is guilty of lawlessness. Sin is lawlessness. You know that he was revealed to take away sins, and in him there is no sin. No one who abides in him sins. No one who sins has either seen him or known him. Little children, let no one deceive you. Everyone who does what is right is righteous, just as he is righteous. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
The Gospel of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, according to Luke. While they were talking about this, Jesus himself stood among them and said to them, "Peace be with you." They were startled and terrified and thought they were seeing a ghost. He said to them, "Why are you frightened? And why do doubts arise in your hearts? Look at my hands and my feet. See that it is I myself. Touch me and see, for a ghost does not have flesh and bones, as you see that I have." And when he had said this, he showed them his hands and his feet. While in their joy they were disbelieving and still wondering, he said to them, "Have you anything here to eat?" They gave him a piece of broiled fish, and he took it and ate in their presence. Then he said to them, "These are my words that I spoke to you while I was still with you, that everything written about me in the law of Moses, the prophets, and the Psalms must be fulfilled." Then he opened their minds to understand the scriptures. And he said to them, "Thus it is written that the Messiah is to suffer
and to rise from the dead on the third day, and that repentance and forgiveness of sins is to be proclaimed in his name to all nations, beginning from Jerusalem. You are witnesses of these things, and see, I am sending upon you what my Father promised. So stay here in this city until you have been clothed with power from on high. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. You may have heard this story. It goes back a few weeks to the beginning of Holy Week, Palm Sunday. Little Billy's family was getting ready to go to church. Obviously, this was pre-COVID. We don't get ready to go to church much anymore. We log on and stream or watch from our televisions and tablets. But anyway, this particular Palm Sunday, little Billy woke up with a fever. Now, Mom was concerned, and she agreed to stay home with Billy while Dad and Billy's siblings went on to Sunday school and to worship. When Dad and little Billy's brother and sister came home from church, well, he was feeling just a bit better, and he noticed that everyone was carrying some green branches in their hands. Being inquisitive, Billy asked, "What are those?" Billy's dad, trying to tell him what happened at church, said, "Well, these are palm branches. And when Jesus came into the church today, we waved our palm branches over his head." Billy simply shook his head in a negative way and said, "I've been going to church all this time, and the one Sunday I miss, Jesus shows up." Now, I hope you see the humor in that story, and yet I can imagine a few of you are probably thinking secretly, "I've been doing this a lot longer than little Billy, and I'm still waiting for Jesus to show up too." I get it. We begin with good intentions, and then week after week after week, we somehow seemingly do the same thing over and over and over, and if we're not careful, we may forget why we have gathered in the first place. Today we are reading from Luke's Gospel. Just prior to today's reading is the familiar story called The Road to Emmaus, where Jesus appeared to two of his followers as they walked along, and they stopped to rest and to eat that evening, and in the sharing of a meal, in the breaking of bread, they recognized Jesus. In today's reading, the disciples have gathered again in Jerusalem, and Jesus appears to the disciples. Similar to last Sunday's text from John, focusing upon Thomas and his questions, Jesus shows up, and the text tells us that they are startled, frightened. And so Jesus again challenges them to look at the wounds on his hands and his feet. Luke tells us he eats with them and they give him a piece of broiled fish. And it says he began to teach them and he opened their minds so that they could understand scriptures. That was some meal, some evening. Often when we gather for our coffee houses with our seasoned and spirited folks, I prompt them with questions about ways to just simply get to know each other. Mostly foolish kinds of questions, but many of you have been in gatherings where you may get this one particular question: who's someone you would like to spend time with if you could go back in history? Where is some place you might like to go? Well, if you ever get that question, I would encourage you to memorize this verse, Luke 24:45. Put it on your list. All of us, I think, would love to be present when Jesus opened their minds to understand Scripture. Can you imagine such a moment? Now, before we go deeper into today's text, I want to remind you of just a couple of things from Luke's Gospel. In chapter 1, the first four verses, Luke kind of introduces his reason for writing the Gospel. He says, "Many have undertaken to give an orderly account of the events that have been fulfilled among us." And in verse 3, Luke says, "I too have decided, after investigating everything carefully from the very first, to write an orderly account for you. And the reason? So that you may know the truth concerning the things about which you have been instructed." To be honest, we really don't know who Luke was. According to early tradition, he was a physician and companion of Paul. He's considered author of both the Gospel of Luke and the Acts of the Apostles. We do know that Luke was a skilled writer, very adept at the Greek language. And there are a lot of themes that are a part of Luke's gospel, and one of those themes that smacks us in the face in the beginning and at the end of the gospel is God's redemptive purposes. God is actively involved in reaching out to humanity, and Jesus in particular is a primary component of God's redemptive work. Luke is only one of two gospels that has a birth narrative. I would remind you of what happens very early in this birth narrative in Luke chapter 2. You remember the angels appear to the shepherds? And their words to the shepherds are, "Do not be afraid. I am bringing you good news of great joy for all people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior who is the Messiah, the Lord." You see, Luke, along with all the other New Testament writers, affirm that we, humanity, are broken, lost, separated from God. And there was nothing we could do to fix it. Only God could provide the remedy, the cure, the vaccine, if you will. And God did so by sending His Son, born as a baby, to grow and experience all that we experience in our humanity. God's Son, Jesus, showed up and showed us what it meant to be human, to be aware and focused upon God's will and God's ways. He taught, He healed, He challenged those in authority. And even with all the beauty and wonder of what Jesus did, we judged Him guilty. And He died on a cross. Now, this is the third Sunday of Easter, so we are well aware of the resurrection. And Luke is very emphatic about the events that testify to the resurrection of Jesus. In chapter 24 alone, he has numerous references to Jesus appearing. In verses 1 through 8, Jesus appears to the women and the two men at the tomb. The women return to the disciples in verses 9 through 11, and they speak to the 11 that we've seen the Lord. Peter rushes out to the tomb to check it out. Verses 13 to 32, there are the two followers on the road to Emmaus and Jesus' encounter with them. Today's text, the disciples are gathered again in a room in Jerusalem. Jesus appears. Following this text, the last five verses of Luke's gospel, the followers of Jesus go with him to Bethany for his ascension. The point of this from Luke, I think, is to simply affirm to us in as many ways as he can that there is evidence that Jesus was resurrected. But Luke also wants us to know, like the other gospel writers, that the disciples were almost always tucked away, hiding, fearful, talking among themselves, walking away from Jerusalem. They didn't believe the women's words when they returned from the tomb. Imagine that, ladies. And just like chapter 2, when the world was in need and Jesus was born, we now have the disciples fearful, baffled, falling apart. And what happens? Jesus comes to them again. Jesus keeps saying to them and to us, "Do not be afraid. Look at my hands, my feet. Watch me eat. Listen again to my words." When the disciples needed to recalibrate their lives, it is Jesus who seeks them out and comes to them. And it is Jesus who seeks us out and comes to us. Jesus keeps showing up. Now, I don't know what you have on your mind at the moment. You may be still thinking about Billy and Palm Sunday and his frustration and your frustration. But I want to share with you, in my own experience, that most often when I need perspective, when I kind of need to be recalibrated, Jesus truly shows up. Often when I least expect it, Jesus comes and does his thing. Many years ago, when I was at the what I thought was ripe old age of 28 and entering seminary, I had been an engineer for 6 years, and I just assumed I'd be the oldest man on campus, somewhere near walking with a cane. Well, it was a different experience. Danner and I made the transition to moving and living in Louisville, Kentucky. We lived off campus, and I started term in January amid what we called J-terms then. But if you can imagine, if you're a young engineer and you're doing well in your career and then you take your leave of that position to pursue this call from God, you kind of have this feeling within you that you're pretty special. Didn't take long for that feeling to go away, but it's one of those feelings you kind of carry with you in your head. You kind of have this idea of, I'm following God's will and God's ways. Well, that specialness dissipated in numerous ways. On our trip to Louisville with our U-Haul and all of our earthly belongings, traveling from Richmond to Louisville on the winding roads of West Virginia, our daughter threw up all over the back seat. When my wife opened the car door to check on her, the dog ran into the woods, and the journey began. When I took my first position with a church while in seminary, this particular church was out in the countryside of Indiana. I'll put it this way. They thought they were really pretty special because they had two-seater outhouses, but they paid $25 a week. If we ate lunch on the way home, we broke even. Now, along with working on the seminary maintenance crew, since I was an engineer, Danner and I took on the position of custodial work in the evenings for a small indoor shopping area. And let me tell you, waxing floors and cleaning toilets 3 times a week is really, really special. But the real kicker for feeling special was when our daughter became ill about halfway through seminary. She was running a fever of high numbers, 104 or so, and we called our doctor and took her to the Children's Hospital there in Louisville, and they admitted her, put her on a cooling blanket. She was tested for all kinds of wonderful things, Rocky Mountain spotted fever, spinal meningitis, a variety of other terrifying words. Around day 3 of our experience, they came to take her bed and her out of the room for this meningitis test, and Danner and I, my wife, just stayed in the room and wept. And the nurse came through the door. She saw that we were emotional wrecks and exited very quickly. And I concluded that they were much more comfortable with children than crying adults. But anyway, we cried, we prayed. And in that painfully simple moment, Jesus showed up. With Jesus present, we took a moment to give our daughters health and life over to the care of the Lord, and in that moment we found we could face whatever came next. In those moments of weeping and praying, when Jesus shows up, everything changes. Now, I'd love to tell you that our daughter instantly got well and we walked out of the hospital that day, but the reality was she was in the hospital for about 16 days. She was diagnosed with something called Kawasaki's disease, a diagnosis reached by excluding all kinds of other illnesses and other terrible things. And if it can't be these things with all of these symptoms, then it must be Kawasaki's. Now, I just want you to know that I will be forever grateful that the Lord came to us and walked with us through that experience. I realize that it's sounds a bit crazy, but one of the things we come to realize in Luke's gospel and all the gospels and the writings of the New Testament is that the power of the gospel and the power that's present to us is not found in what we can do, It's all about what God can do. And it's ultimately found in what we encounter in that experience when we encounter Jesus. Our lives change from that moment forward. It's one of the reasons why worship is so powerful and so important. This time of gathering and putting into perspective who we are in relation to the God of creation. The liturgy, the music, the prayers, sometimes the sermon. We never know exactly what, but often when we least expect it, our minds are all over the place, wham, God grabs us. God speaks to us in a very intimate and personal way. Now, I'm guessing you're like most people. You're too afraid to share that with anyone because they may think your elevator doesn't make it all the way to the top floor. But we know it happened. We know in our lives when Jesus shows up. And it doesn't have to only be in worship. It happens in special places like retreats and Bible studies. It happens when we're helping others through food pantries and hygiene drives. It happens on things like packing meals for World Hunger or hiking to Catoctin Falls. Sometimes it happens when we need wisdom as parents or when we need patience to deal with aging family members. When Jesus shows up, we find ourselves encouraged. Those words, "do not be afraid," have new meaning. And I hope you will agree with me on this, that when we try to show up for others, we want Jesus to show up with us. Jesus commissions us to declare the presence and power of God in the midst of tragedy and despair. And as difficult as those moments may be for those going through them, those moments are not ultimate. God is. And the risen Christ makes himself known to us in ways large and small through us and through others. When it comes to funerals, memorials, wakes, a part of the power of these rituals is the power of presence to heal, to comfort. In many of my ministry locations, I've tried to give deacons and others who were interested in tools for ministering to individuals and families who face crises, both physically and spiritually, training. So many of us, I find, want to avoid those situations because, well, we're just not sure what's going to happen, and often we're afraid someone's going to ask us a question, ask us to say something or do something, and we may not know what to say, to do, to answer. And so one of the first lessons to be taught for those who want to care for others is to be present. It's not your words, but your presence that matters. My father died relatively young. He was 59. Our daughter was born in September, and my father died in December of 1979. Now, I'd love to tell you my dad was an integral part of my life, but to be honest, that just wasn't the parenting style of the 50s and 60s. It was more the stay out of trouble or you'll really be in trouble kind of style. My dad was not a church person, even though we lived directly across the street from where my mother, brother, and I attended church and attended faithfully. Now, I don't need to go into all the reasons he didn't go to church. Let's just say he didn't find it necessary for his life. So when he died at age 59, I was 27, all kinds of things began to go through my mind as I was helping my mom to process this and plan the funeral and deal with my own grief. One area that was of great concern to me was that my three-month-old daughter would never know my father. And someone challenged me about that and said, "That's now your calling. That's now your task. You need to make sure that your children know your father, your family." I also had this fear because my dad was not a church person. We would have this funeral and no one would be there. I mean, why should anyone be there? My dad was a carpenter. Most of his jobs were out of town in various locations. And if I'm truly honest, I'm not sure if my dad ever had a friend. Never saw him hang out with anybody. I just wondered, who's going to be there? Well, the day of the funeral, there at this funeral home in this small town I grew up in, there was a chapel full of people, mostly from the church we attended. And I need to tell you, for me, I was deeply and powerfully moved by their presence in our time of grief. And I want you to know that Jesus showed up in and through them. What I want you to hear in this message this morning is that Jesus keeps seeking us out. Jesus keeps showing up. And if you want to know why he does that, the answer is simple. That's what love does. The Apostle Paul put it this way. Love is patient. Love is kind. Love bears all things, believes all things, hopes all things. Love never ends. In John's letter, as we heard this morning, he phrased it in this way. See what love the Father has given us, that we should be called children of God. And that is what we are. So wherever you are, whatever you're experiencing, get ready. Be ready. Because Jesus is going to keep showing up. May this be so with you and with me.
There is more.
With the saints through the ages, let us affirm in the God who is with us as we pray, as we affirm our faith using the words of the Nicene Creed. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven, was incarnate of the Holy Spirit and the Virgin Mary, and became truly human. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son is worshipped and glorified, who has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. This morning, as we gather together in prayer, I invite you to express prayers of thanksgiving and gratitude and prayers of need on the Facebook Live feed as we pray together. God of resurrection, hear our prayer. God of resurrection, hear our prayer. For the church throughout the world, that as we celebrate the great 50 days of Easter, we may renew our faith and strengthen our witness in Jesus' name. God of resurrection, hear our prayer. For the church, O God, that we may recognize the risen Christ in word and sacrament and in other ways too, and that we may be your church, filled with wisdom, and yet filled with humility, and yet filled with great courage. God of resurrection,
hear our prayer.
For the governments of this world and its leaders, especially we pray for our President Joe, that all may resist the corruption of sin and serve the common good. God of resurrection,
hear our prayer.
For our planet Earth, that all people may be good stewards of its resources and share in its abundance. God of resurrection,
hear our prayer.
For the poor and the stranger, that they may receive a place of refuge and hope, and that the church may offer the hospitality the first disciple offered to Jesus on the road to Emmaus. God of resurrection,
hear our prayer.
O God, we pray for the sick and those in distress, that they may find healing for their pain and be restored to fullness of life. Especially, O God, hear our prayers now for those we name before you. God of resurrection,
hear our prayer.
For our neighbors, that we may live together in peace and share in our resources. God of resurrection,
hear our prayer.
For our enemies, O God, that they may receive good things, and that we, your servants, not return evil for evil. God of resurrection,
hear our prayer.
Almighty God, receive these and all prayers that we bring to you, And by the power of your Holy Spirit, use us for the sake of the gospel of Jesus Christ. And may we do what we can do to make you known here in our lives, in the life of this church, and in the life of this world. For we pray in the name of Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
All good things come from God, the giver of life. We are called as stewards of God's gifts to share in the fulfillment of God's purposes for creation. As stewards of the kingdom of God, let us give from our gifts with thanksgiving. The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
Holy One, your heart abounds with gifts. Receive this, our offering, as a sign of our trust and our intention to live surrounded by your mercy, inspired by your Spirit, open to the joy of your presence, hospitable to one another, and generous toward your world. For we offer these gifts in the name of Jesus the Christ, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Thank you.
love and serve the Lord in the power of the resurrection. Alleluia. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed.
Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed.
Alleluia. Christ is risen.
The Lord is risen indeed. Alleluia. Alleluia.